إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على حبيبنا وشفيعنا وملاذنا وقرة عيوننا محمد صلوات ربي وسلامه عليه. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه في الأولين، وصل وسلم وبارك عليه في الآخرين، وصل وسلم وبارك عليه في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. In the name of Allah, the gracious, the merciful, to him we belong and to him we shall return. We ask Allah Jalla Jalaluhu in his infinite wisdom and boundless mercy to send an abundance of prayers and peace upon our beloved messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove the hardships from upon our brothers and sisters across the world. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy upon us and to have mercy upon our parents and to have mercy upon this ummah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alleviate the pains of this ummah and alleviate the hardships from upon those who are oppressed. May Allah preserve our iman and our Islam in our hearts. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not allow us to leave this earth except without having made the absolute testimony of La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Brothers and sisters, all too often when we come to think about this idea of being religious, when we come to hold ourselves to account, we do our own type of muhasabah to think, am I being a good Muslim? We usually go to very specific qualities, things that are related to my own personal self. So for example, I think about my salah. Is my salah good? I think about my siyam, my zakah, my hajj. I think about whether or not I'm sinning and how often I'm sinning and am I making tawbah. So when we think about being religious and we think about religiosity, we all too often think about a very personal type of endeavor. However, when we dig deeper into our sources, we dig deeper into the Quran and Sunnah and the life of our beloved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, we see that there is a critical component that must be attached to this personal reflection for our iman and our Islam to be complete. There's a beautiful hadith that I want you to pay attention to. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrates to us, جَاءَ رَجُلْ إِلَى النَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. A man came to the beloved messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فَقَالَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ أَيُّ النَّاسِ أَحَبُّ إِلَى اللَّهِ. Which people are the most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? وَأَيُّ الْأَعْمَالِ أَحَبُّ إِلَى اللَّهِ. And which actions are the most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So I want you to pay attention. I want you to close your eyes and open your heart and listen to the response of our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because what he's talking to us about is one of the highest maqamat, the maqam of Allah loving us. So which people are the most beloved to Allah? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, أَحَبُّ النَّاسِ إِلَى اللَّهِ أَنْفَعُهُمْ لِلنَّاسِ. That the most beloved people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the ones who bring the most benefit to people. وَأَحَبُّ الْأَعْمَالِ إِلَى اللَّهِ. And the most beloved actions to Allah, سُرُورٌ تُدْخِلُهُ فِي قَلْبِ أَخِيكَ أو أَخِيكَ الْمُسْلِمِ. Happiness that you bring into your brother's heart. أَوْ كُرْبَ تَكْشِفْهُ عَنْهُ. Or you remove from upon them a kurba, a hardship. أو تقضي عنه دينا, or that you pay off one of their debts, or تطرد عنه جوعا, or you rid them of hunger. Subhanallah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the Prophet is speaking to us about how Allah will come to love his servants, he speaks about bringing benefit to others. That the best of actions that Allah loves to see is when you go and you feed someone who's hungry, or you go and you pay off someone's debt, or you bring happiness to someone's heart, or you relieve them of a hardship. And the Prophet ﷺ says in this hadith, لَأَنْ أَمْشِيَ مَعَ أَخٍ لِي في حاجة له أحب إلي من أن أعتكف في مسجدي هذا شهرا. That for I to go out with a brother of mine to fulfill a need that they may have is more beloved to me than to make i'tikaf in my masjid, al-masjid al-Nabawi, for an entire month. And the Prophet ﷺ concludes this hadith by saying, وَمَنْ مَشَى مَا أَخٍ لَهُ فِي حَاجَةٍ أَثْبَتَهُ لَهُ, meaning that you went out with your brother and you fulfilled their needs until that need was completely fulfilled. ثَبَّتَ اللَّهُ قَدَمَهُ عَلَى الصِّرَاطِ يَوْمَ تَزِلُّ فِيهِ الْأَقْدَامِ. That if you go out with your brother or your sister and you complete their need, not just that you went out in the beginning, you kind of put them on the path and you left them, no, that you saw the entire journey through, then just as you affirmed their need to be fulfilled, Allah will ensure that your feet will be steadfast on the sirat when the feet will be slipping. So brothers and sisters, we're talking about a high maqam with Allah. And so for a person to be truly a believer, it necessitates that you are a person who is constantly bringing benefit to others. And the Prophet also teaches us that إِذَا أَحَبَّ اللَّهُ عَبْدًا, if Allah loves a servant, يُنَادِي جِبْرِيلِ, and he says, يَا جِبْرِيلِ إِنِّي أُحِبُّ فُلَانِ فَأَحِبَّهُ. Oh Jibreel, I love so and so, so love him. ثُمَّ يُنَادِي جِبْرِيلِ أَهْلَ السَّمَاءِ, he says, يَا أَهْلَ السَّمَاءِ إِنَّ اللَّهُ يُحِبُّ فُلَانِ فَأَحِبُّهُ. O dwellers of the skies, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves this person, so love him. ثُمَّ يُوضَعَ لَهُ الْقَبُولُ فِي الْأَرْضِ. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places for this person acceptance on earth. So not only when you attain Allah's love does Allah place for you love on this earth that people love you and accept you, but Allah makes it that the malaika ahlu sama' love you. And the most importantly, that Allah Jalla Jalaluhu himself loves you. And so we're talking about how to attain that love. And what it necessitates is iman billah, that yes, we consider our own ibadat, we think about our sins and our deeds and so on and so forth, but coupled with that, we are constantly thinking about how we are bringing benefit to others. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. That is always the discourse of the Qur'an. Those who believe and those who do righteous deeds. And so I want us to completely reconsider for ourselves what it means to be religious. That being religious necessitates that we are of benefit to others and we are in the service of others. And this is beautifully manifested in the life of Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. One time the Prophet is sitting with the companions. So the Prophet asks, من أصبح منكم صائما? Who today woke up fasting? Abu Bakr raises his hand. مَنْ مَشَى مِنْكُمْ فِي جَنَازَةٍ? Who amongst you walked in a funeral procession? Abu Bakr raises his hand. مَنْ عَادَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا? Who visited a sick person? Abu Bakr raises his hand. مَنْ أَطْعَمَ مِسْكِينًا? Abu Bakr raises his hand. So the companions are confused. And the Prophet ﷺ says, مَجْتَمَعْنَا فِي رَجُلٍ إِلَّا أَدْخَلَهُ اللَّهُ الْجَنَّةِ. That when these qualities are found in a man, and by that man and women, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guarantees that person Jannah. So the companion said, Ya Rasulullah, you know, what is it that Abu Bakr made him, I mean, what made him this way? This is early in the morning, by the way. They're still early in the morning. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave them the secret. He said, مَا سَبَقَكُمْ بِكَثِيرِ صَلَاتٍ وَصِيَامٍ. When it came to prayer and fast, Abu Bakr was actually quite similar to you guys in your prayers and fast. وَلَكِنْ سَبَقَكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ وَقَرَ فِي قَلْبِهِ أَلَا وَهُوَ الْإِيمَانِ. Rather, he outdid you with something that settled in his heart, and that was iman. And how Abu Bakr's iman was manifested, when you go back to all of what Abu Bakr responded to, it was all actions that were being done in the service of others. When he found there was a janazah, he quickly rushed to go follow in the footsteps of that janazah. When he knew that there was a sick person that needed to be visited, he immediately rushed to visit that person. When he knew that there was someone who needed food, he didn't go around trying to ask people. He went immediately to feed that person. So the manifestation of his iman was one of what? Someone who served others. And when you see this, even when he entered into Islam, immediately after entering into Islam, Sayyidina Abu Bakr did something remarkable. All he had in his heart was the affirmation of La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah. And the first actions he did, he went to free slaves. And he just started freeing slaves as much as he could. And he only freed really the weak slaves. All of the slaves that he freed were weak, beaten, downtrodden. So his father, Abu Quhafa, says, you know, perhaps you can free a couple of slaves who are strong, who will actually help us, because all of the slaves that you're freeing are not really of benefit to us. So Abu Bakr told him, Father, I am not freeing these slaves so that they could serve me. I am freeing these slaves so I can realize my servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That being a true servant of Allah necessitates that I am bringing benefit to others. And brothers and sisters, this is what I want us to consider when we're thinking about our iman. Think about when the Prophet first received revelation, and he was terrified, and he ran to Khadija, and he said, "Inni khashitu ala nafsi," I'm worried about myself, ya Khadija. What did she say to him? What did she tell him to comfort his heart? She said, "Kalla la yuhzik Allahu abada," Allah will never forsake you. Why did she know that Allah would never forsake him? She explained. She said, "Innaka la tasil al-rahm, wa taksib al-ma'doom, wa tuqri al-dayf, wa tahmil al-kal, wa tu'inu ala nawa'ib al-dahr." Ya Muhammad, you will not be forsaken by Allah because you embody these qualities. You keep the bonds with your relatives. You take care of your relatives and your kith and kin. You uplift those who have been destitute, who have been made destitute. You help those who have, the times have hurt them. You take care of those who come and visit your home, your guests. You're a man who serves others. There's no way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forsake you. So subhanAllah, what Khadija understood was, Allah loves people who serve others. And that is part and parcel of our iman, brothers and sisters. And that's why I want us as a community to collectively ask ourselves, where is our service of others? Do we, when we wake up in the morning, like Sayyidina Abu Bakr did, think to themselves, where can I help others? Because truly, it is very challenging today. We live in a moment in time where the obsession with the self is at an all-time high. It's about I, me, and my every single day. We wake up and the obsession is, I need to worry about myself, my pockets, my bottom line, my profit margin. That's my concern. And when I come to consider my religiosity, I'm thinking about my prayers and my fast. However, coupled with that, and yes, that is a critical question, coupled with that must be, how much benefit am I bringing to society? Because the Prophet ﷺ was someone who brought an abundance of benefit to people. That's his entirety, the entirety of his life was one of, how can I serve others? You know, think about this recent storm, this wintry, this blistering cold that we've been in. And wallahi, this is a question I pose to myself before I pose to any of you. How many of us thought to ourselves, perhaps I have plenty of blankets and socks and scarves in my home. Let me put them in my trunk, drive down to downtown Patterson and see people who are on the streets and give them a blanket. Just a simple act of service that allows you to realize your servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many of you think to yourselves, I know I have a relative who's in need, who's starving, who's hungry, whose children are struggling, who can't find proper education. I have a little bit extra. I will ensure that I am the first one to go. I won't look to others to fill in, but rather I will jump to the opportunity to help this person. These are specifically the type of critical questions that we have to pose to ourselves. The Prophet's life was full of service to others. There's one beautiful example I want to share with you. That one time, and I want you to see how beautiful the service of the Prophet ﷺ to others, how it affected and impacted society and the people around him. The Prophet ﷺ was at the outskirts of Mecca one day, and he sees an elderly woman, and she's carrying some belongings. So the Prophet ﷺ tells her, you know, perhaps I can help you with these things. They look heavy. I'll walk with you to the city center. She says, oh, thank you. And yes, of course, you look like a nice man. She had no idea who he was. So she decided that on their journey, that as they're walking to the city center, she'd give him some advice. So she said, my son, I want to give you some advice. There is this man, an evil man. His name is Muhammad. and he's come and he's trying to destroy our way of life. And he's insulting our forefathers. And he's trying to take us away from our religion. And he's calling us to this new religion that we don't know what it is. I warn you about him. Don't listen to him. If he comes to talk to you, turn away from him. And you can imagine the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam walking with her, and he's probably smiling. And he's probably, you know, listening to her attentively and calmly until they arrive at their destination. The Prophet doesn't say anything. So she says to him, "My son, what's your name?" He said, "I am Muhammad, the one that you've been talking about." So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that, and she was shocked. She said, "There's no way that you are Muhammad. Muhammad is an evil man, but you're a nice, handsome, gentle, kind. You've helped me so much. There's no way you're this man." He said, "By Allah, I am this person." She said, "If you are this man, if Muhammad is you, and you are calling to this, I bear witness that there is no God and that you are the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That there is no God but Allah and that you are the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." It was a simple act of service that softened this woman's heart to enter into the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet never hesitated to give in the way of Allah and to serve others, not because he wanted people to be pleased with him, but rather because it was his duty as a prophet of Allah to serve humanity. And the byproduct was what? That when people saw a true servant of Allah, they couldn't but deny the beauty of that person. And so as we think of ourselves in our day-to-day lives, we think to ourselves, I need to be, and I need to be a person who brings benefit to others, not only because, yes, I want the love of Allah, but for me to really attain the love of Allah, I have to serve others. But that's what I want to attain. I want to serve others to attain the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I want to do what the Prophet says. I want to bring happiness to people's hearts. Sururun tudkhiluhu fi qalbi akhik. Happiness that you bring into someone's heart. The Prophet ﷺ was not only worried about servicing others, but he was also concerned about people's hearts, even children. His grandchildren, Hassan and Hussein, when they would be riding on the back of the Prophet while he was in sujood, and we all see this when the children jump on the father's back. He's in sujood, and the Prophet says, "I did not get up from sujood until I made sure that my grandchildren, they had enough fun, that their hearts were content in terms of the pleasure they wanted to achieve from riding on my back." And he didn't come up from sujood for that reason. The Prophet was a man who was concerned about people's hearts, who was concerned about others in society, who was selfless. And brothers and sisters, these are precisely the questions that I want each and every single one of us to consider for ourselves. As a community, are we people who facilitate for ourselves opportunity to serve or not? Are we people who wake up in the morning thinking to ourselves, how can I serve others? How can I bring benefit to others? Alhamdulillah, there are some ideas that are beginning to brew in our communities, in our committees, about how we can serve others. But wallahi, we need the collective input of everyone here, the collective resources of everyone here, to come together to think of creative ways to be people of service, people who bring benefit to others. This Sunday, we have a town hall meeting where everyone here is expected to come to join in a very rich and vibrant conversation about how we can be people of service, how we can be people of true benefit, not only to help people in society, but to attain the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to have that maqam where Allah loves us, and that we are people who are able to realize their iman. So everyone should join us this Sunday. Bring your suggestions. How can we build our community? How can we grow our community? How can we fulfill the needs of our community and the greater society at large? We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us a people who bring benefit to others, a people who are of service to others. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to use us for this deen and not replace us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us with His love. May Allah grant us His love. May Allah elevate our condition, guide us towards righteousness and goodness. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. Brothers and sisters, in closing, one of our great pious predecessors is a man by the name of Ali Zainul Abidin. He is the grandson of Sayyidina Ali, سو علي ابن الحسين ابن علي رضي الله عنهم أجمعين. علي زين العابدين was known for his infaq. He was a man who was truly generous and he gave as much as he could. And he was known so much so for that specific quality that Al-Farazdaq, who is a great poet, he wrote an entire qasida praising Ali Zain al-Abidin. And in that qasida, he wrote something very beautiful. He said, مَا قَالَ لَا قَطُّ إِلَّا فِي تَشَهُدِهِ وَلَوْلَا التَّشَهُدُ لَكَانَتْ لَاؤُهُ نَعَمْ. That when Ali Zain al-Abidin was asked for something, he never said no. مَا قَالَ لَا قَطُّ. He never said no. And if it weren't for the fact that we had the tashahud to say la ilaha illallah, that all of his la's would be na'am, would be yes. That the only time he said la, no, was in the tashahud. That's the type of person he was. When he was presented with an opportunity to give, he gave. And he didn't think twice. He was of service. When he saw someone walking and they needed help, he's the first one who rushed. Old woman, young child, whatever it was, I am here and I am here to help. And one of the beautiful stories is the people of Medina during the time of Sayyidina Ali, Ali Zain al-Abidin, they became very accustomed to waking up and finding bread and a few foodstuffs on their doorsteps for many years. And they had no idea who the source was. They thought it was the Hakim who was presenting it. Until the death of Ali Zain al-Abidin. The morning after they woke up and they found no bread on the doorstep. And so Muhammad ibn Ishaq says that what we realized was Ali Zain al-Abidin, every single night while the people were sleeping, he himself, and he was a very well-respected high member of society, he would carry bushels of bread on his back and he would go out and he would put bread on each and every single person's doorstep. Sadaqatu sir, that's the type of person he was. I'm going to give, and I'm going to give when no one sees me. And we may think to myself, you know, this is a distant example. This is Sayyidina, this is Ali Zain al-Abidin, the grandson of Sayyidina Ali. You know, who are we from him? Let me give you a living example. A man who's still alive, and he's from our communities. And this is narrated to me by my father. So, and my father. My father narrates to me this story. One time my father was in a wedding. And he didn't know many of the people who were there. And so he says, a man came up to me and he said, brother, I noticed that you are here and you don't know many. Let me introduce myself. So they start to introduce themselves and the man says, you know, who are you? My father says, this is who I am. And the man says, where are you from? He says, I'm from Egypt. He says, oh, you're Egyptian. Oh, I know a beautiful Egyptian brother I need to tell you about. Do you know Sayyid Amir? Brother Sayyid Amir. He says, yes, of course, he's a beloved friend of mine. We came decades ago together. He said, let me tell you a story of brother Sayyid Amir. And many of you probably know Ammu Sayyid Amir, as I call him. He says to my father, many, many years ago, we established a masjid here in Long Island. And it was our first Ramadan, and we really didn't have our things in order. And the first night, the people left, and the masjid was a mess. And we started to struggle, who's going to clean, what we're going to do. So they said, you know what, we'll come the next morning and we'll figure out how to clean the masjid. You know, we'll hire somebody or so on. They came the next morning and they found the masjid spotless. Subhanallah. So they said, you know, who did this? And they started to ask one another. No one knew. The second day after Taraweeh, they came the next morning. The same thing happened. Second day, third day, fourth day. Each day they come back the next day and the masjid is spotless. So a group of them said, you know what, we have to camp out in our car and try to see, you know, who's cleaning the masjid. So they said at 1 a.m., they were sitting in the car and a car pulled up. It was Ammu Sayyid Amir. He had a bucket full of cleaning products and he would go in quietly and clean the entire masjid from top to bottom without anyone seeing, without anyone knowing. And my father says that he would probably be bothered that if I share this story, but he's not here. And he's still with us, alhamdulillah. Make dua that Allah gives him shifa. But I say this because he deserves our dua and he deserves that we follow in his footsteps and that we try to embody those types of beautiful virtues in our lives, that we become people of true benefit and service to others in our community. So may Allah use us for his religion. May Allah make us a people who love to serve. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us a people who love to be of benefit to others. May Allah put in our hearts the love to be present for others. to take care of our children, to take care of our families, to take care of our relatives, to be at service to our neighbors, to be of service to our societies and our communities at large. May Allah make this community a community of service, a community who cares about their fellow brethren in society, Muslim and non-Muslim. May Allah make this truly a part of our iman and a part of our Islam. May Allah allow us to realize the totality of our iman in our Islam. Allahumma hadina fi man hadayt, wa afina fi man afayt, wa tawallana fi man tawallayt, wa barik Allahumma lana fi ma atayt, wa qina wasrif anna sharra ma qadayt, innaka taqdi bil haqqi wa la yuqda alayk. Allahumma ya wasil al munqati'in awsilna ilayk. اللهم هب لنا عملا صالحا متقبلا يقربنا إليك. اللهم استرنا فوق الأرض وتحت الأرض ويوم العرض عليك. كن لنا ولا تكن علينا. أعنا ولا تعن علينا. وصل اللهم على سيدنا محمد. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.